The Future History of Energy and Transportation. Documenting the paradigm shift from the era of oil and internal combustion to the era of robotics. By Julian Cox. Narrated by the author with the aid of an artificial intelligence. Chapter 14. Labor level efficiency explored. As previously alluded to, the energy content of gasoline is relativistic mass just like it is in electricity, hence the primary difference between using gasoline and electricity is the requirement to move the bulk of gasoline to a vehicle in preparation for receiving miles of output. The energy density of an electrical charge added to a battery is 24,962,556 gigawatt-hours per kilogram. This is precisely what allows a nuclear bomb to flatten a city by instantly annihilating barely a kilogram of matter. This is why less than a paint chip's worth of mass, and with no abnormal radiation and no fallout of any kind, just to be absolutely clear, is perfectly sufficient to drive 300,000 miles in a full-sized high-performance sedan over the course of 20 years. This also gives a hint as to why digging up, transporting, processing, distributing and ultimately burning 30.3 tons of materials to carry less than a paint fleck's worth of energy and creating 97.2 tons of emissions in the process, is not an equally sensible use of labor resources to compare with building assets to arrange for practically massless energy to flow through wires to a battery, after similarly massless energy falls onto a passive, solar, energy collector. If any of that produces complexity in terms of timing and routing, it is just to throw computer network intelligence into the mix, a smart grid, to negate the complexity, and then to buffer the network with grid storage, wherever intelligent anticipation, scheduling, routing and charging rate coordination with a connected road fleet is inadequate. The bottom line, the sum of all labor to deliver value in the form of passenger miles is the cost of transportation. In other words, labor level efficiency is the output of useful work received by humans multiplied by natural processes and machines, divided by the input of human labor to supply and service the machines. Reduced to its essence, the net whole of system ability of a tool to enhance the power of human beings. This is why the sledge was replaced with the wheel and the horse was replaced with the automobile. The labor and materials cost of maintaining horses was excessive. Not only for feeding, shoeing and veterinary care, but partly because labor was necessarily allocated to disposal of manure. Cost pivots on societal level energy efficiency, but also materials level efficiency. The bottom line is labor level efficiency. The flow and stagnation of capital and the eddies of politics generally, ensures that a great well of societal pressure tends to build before fundamental technology monopolies burst, but the direction of flow from arduous labor to freedom from arduous labor and from labor inefficiency to labor efficiency is unstoppable, so long as a civilization itself survives. Historically, war tended to accelerate rather than decelerate this process out of necessity, however, nuclear proliferation has likely changed that calculus. We will take a look at emissions separately. Because having accounted for the value inputs of energy, materials and labor, eliminating waste to the atmosphere neither adds nor subtracts significant value in the context of delivering passenger miles. It is a serious issue, just one that is tangential to energy efficiency. Perhaps most important is the inverse. Conflating emissions with efficiency has resulted in endless confusion and futility in public debate. EV manufacturers and gasoline vehicle manufacturers can charge their customers exactly the same for emissions. Zero. In the 1990s, Japan stormed the US and European vehicle markets with comparatively high efficiency vehicles and never stopped storming since then. Result, Toyota became the first or second largest global polluter in terms of vehicle emissions in tight competition with VW. Not per vehicle but in aggregate. In more recent years, Toyota has expended vast sums of money lobbying against electrification of transport, by seeking to seriously undermine cogent public policy with hydrogen, something that fails every single test of efficiency described herein beyond the component level and even then by ignoring components necessary to the function of a moving vehicle. A more complete discussion of hydrogen is provided in the chapter entitled Hydrogen and Earth. Yet the final driver of technological advancement in transportation is not the imperative to exploit a particular methane deposit or to advance any particular technology or policy agenda. It is the reduction in total human labor required to deliver a quality customer mile to other humans. The approach that wins on this metric wins the economy. It is inescapably the case that mine once, build once, drive 300,000 miles, or more, is unsurpassably labor-efficient at scale in the direction of ambient energy capture such as solar and smart grids, combined with battery storage and electric vehicles, when compared with mining and refining continually just to keep traffic flowing. Note that the cheaper something fundamental like a unit of transportation becomes, in terms of human labor content, not only does it broaden access to quality of life for the poorest in society, but the more of it the wealthiest individuals and institutions can afford. This is the direction of military might, scientific exploration, grand corporations and luxury. Not austerity and bland utility. From the most affordable to the most prestigious, the quality of transportation in the direction of efficiency will not diminish. It will predictably improve, dramatically. In this regard, there is much to be said of energy and materials efficiency in relation to electrification. That said, the most dramatic multiplier of human efficiency isn't to be found in marginal cost reductions between solar or wind and fossil fuels. It is to be found in robotics.